I just got a new keyboard. Isn't it great? But wait a minute, where are these wires connected to it? Why is there a mouse and a monitor connected to it and a laptop power brick? Well, that's because this is not just a keyboard, it's a keyboard PC. The entire computer is in the keyboard. You may remember I did a video about something very similar, the K3 Wintel keyboard PC, which you can buy for about $100, give or take a little bit. Complete computer built into a keyboard. Well, this is the same idea, except it's a couple years older. It's from 2011, and it's not quite as fast as this one, but it's better in almost every way. As you can see right away, it has a full-size keyboard, so it's not missing any keys, and the keys are full-sized, but there is no built-in touchpad, so you have to use an external mouse. Although this one is unbranded on both the box and the unit itself, it is called the Great Wall U310. It was also sold by Diablo Tech. That was sold at Micro Center for around $200. It's also sold by GigaZone, and perhaps most famously, this was rebranded as the Commodore VIC Slim during the brief period when a company called Commodore USA owned the rights to the Commodore name, and they made a modern-day reproduction of the Commodore 64 with modern PC hardware inside called the Commodore 64X. And this was their other model, although I don't know if they ever actually sold that many of these, because the only one I've ever seen is one that was shown in a YouTube video, and then a couple years later the same guy sold it on eBay, and that's the only one I've ever seen. So I don't know if that was just a prototype or if they actually ever made them, but nonetheless I'll link to that video in the description if you want to see it. But this is the same thing, just without any brand name on it. You can see some of the features on the box. It says Linux inside, 2 gigs of memory, but that's only if you buy the full version. Whereas this was the bare bones version, which you had to supply your own hard drive and RAM and install your own operating system on it. But the eBay seller I got mine from didn't understand that, so they advertised it as 4 parts are not working. They said it does not power on. Well, obviously a computer without any RAM would not power on. So they say it's defective and does not work. And I got it for $22.94 of free shipping. And it came in this box. And you can see they appear to have written DOA on it, indicating dead on arrival, but I popped in some laptop RAM. It uses DDR3 SODIMM and a hard drive, or actually in this case a solid state drive, and it works. Other features include Ethernet, audio, low noise. It does have a built-in fan, but it's rather quiet. Mouse. Originally it did come with mouse. This one I got did not include it. Intel VGA graphics, USB, Wi-Fi, and low carbon. More specs on the back of the box. You can see the bare bones version listed here. Intel Atom D525 1.8 GHz dual core CPU. Available with either Linux or Windows 7 Starter Edition. 2 speakers inside. It does include internal speakers, unlike the other keyboard PC I reviewed. The full version came with 250 GB hard drive. Well, this one you have to supply it yourself. It's a 2.5-inch SATA laptop drive. Line out, USB 2.0, VGA, RJ45 Ethernet, DCN, and the COM port. Does actually have a serial port, which I'll show you in a minute. Fully integrated PC. Something got rubbed off, so you can't read it, but eco-friendly and energy efficient. I guess that's what they meant to say there. Quiet in operation, high scalability, I don't know what that means. Burglar-proof design, I'll also show that. Wireless N power, no battery. This does not run on batteries, although it does run on 19 volts DC, so you can connect it to an external battery if you wanted to run it on battery power. Azalea codec, audio, 2 speakers on the side, GMA 3150 Intel graphics, and there's the dimensions, made in China. And there's the unit itself again. The keyboard is a flat design, styled to look like a chiclet keyboard, but it's not chiclet. You can see the keys don't have any frame around them. So it's actually a pretty nice keyboard, a full-sized keyboard. All the normal keys and normal layout you would expect. Here's some indicators for num lock, scroll lock, and caps lock. Hard drive and power indicators do not appear to work. I don't know why. On the left side, you have one of the two built-in speakers, another USB port, microphone and headphone jacks, although these are software definable. When you plug anything in, it asks you if you want to use it as a line in, line out, microphone, or headphones. So if you want to, you can plug your headphones into the microphone jack, and you can plug a line in into the headphone jack. It doesn't matter. You can choose what you want. And there's the power button. On the right side is just the other built-in speaker. On the back, there's three more USB ports, none of which appear to work on this one. So I think maybe there's something disconnected, or maybe a broken solder joint or something. I'll have to open this one and investigate that. There's the output for the cooling fan. There's a blank for what would have been an HDMI output. I've never seen one of these with that equipped, so I don't know if they ever made any of that feature. Ethernet. There's the serial port. And here's the trap door where you plug in your VGA monitor and a USB mouse. And you can see you can screw this door shut to reduce the chance of somebody being able to quickly unplug these and walk away with the computer. So that's why they call it burglar proof. These are mainly designed for use in schools and as point of sale systems. And there's the DC power input. It takes a Toshiba sized barrel plug, so I was able to use the power supply from my Toshiba laptop and it works fine. On the bottom you can see the trap door for the hard drive, another trap door for the RAM. And here's the label, keyboard PC, 19 volts DC at 2.1 amps. I don't know what that enterprise standard means. Manufactured in China. Please use the exclusive AC adapter. Well, doesn't appear to be that exclusive because I was able to use a Toshiba adapter and it works fine. And there you can see model U310BB, the BB indicating bare bones. And that may be a date code, 2011, and then a bunch of numbers. So this was made in 2011 and is no longer in production, unfortunately. Here's the quick user guide and driver CD it comes with, neither of which have any company name or branding on them. The quick user guide is very basic, doesn't really have that much detailed information except an overview of the different ports and features of the keyboard PC. It's in mostly understandable English. There's just this one strange warning here saying this product must be in use when this distance of 20 centimeters from the human body. Not quite sure what that's talking about. So I plugged it back in, now I can turn it on. And in a moment, you'll see the BIOS screen appear. Monitor just turned on. I'll hit delete to get into setup. It has an American Megatrends BIOS. And you can see the CPU and the RAM. BIOS version 1.01 from September 29th, 2011. Not too many options in this. Advanced settings, just a couple things there. You can change the boot order. And you can set a password, and that's really about it. So nothing special in the BIOS. So I'll just exit out of that. There it's starting Windows. This is a drive I pulled out of my HP computer over there. And I just plugged it in. And once it installed the drivers, it works fine. I did not have to reinstall Windows. And there you can see it's already started up. And those were the built-in speakers, which don't get very loud and they sound rather tinny, but at least it has built-in speakers. We can go into the properties here. I'm running Windows Pause Ready 2009 on this. You can see the CPU and the RAM. And Device Manager has all the drivers installed. It did include a driver's CD, which has drivers for Windows XP, Vista, and Windows 7. And as you saw, it also supports Linux. So I have all my typical software installed on this, and it runs perfectly fine.
This is the VIC Slim, the low end. And I'm going to give you a good look at it and let you see it running. This is the actual computer. The entire thing in a keyboard. I'm going to put my hands in to give you a good sense of scale.
Has no problem playing YouTube videos, and those were the internal speakers you heard. Has no problem playing full screen 720p HD video on YouTube. Although I don't think 1080p would work so well, and I would definitely recommend using the Pale Moon browser, which is based on Firefox, and they have a special version optimized for the Intel Atom CPU, which is what I'm using here. For size comparison, you can see it's pretty much the same size as a normal desktop keyboard. It's more along the lines of a slimline keyboard due to the low profile of the keys. There are no adjustable feet, but it does have a slight angle built in. And it is a nice looking machine with this brushed finish around the edge and a glossy black inlay and bright blue LEDs for the lock lights, which are not blindingly bright, unlike the power LED in my Inwin case. And as far as scissor switch keyboards go, this one is pretty good. The keys are almost silent in operation, and they have a decent feel to them. They're fairly tactile and have a decent amount of travel, especially the enter key feels nicely tactile. The only thing that took me a little bit of getting used to is this small backspace key, which is not normally a problem, but due to the low profile of this keyboard, I tended to hit insert instead of backspace because I couldn't feel the edge of it until I got used to the exact distance it is away from the home row. And now I don't have any problem with it. And I'll give you a short typing sample. And as I mentioned, it's not quite as fast as this K3 keyboard PC I reviewed, because it is a couple years older. And here are my scribbled results using Passmark performance test. Overall, the K3 is much faster because it heavily weights 3D graphics, which, as you can see, the U310 keyboard PC is absolutely terrible for 3D graphics. So this is definitely not a computer for gaming. But in terms of CPU performance, it's not too bad. 642 versus 992. So it's comparable to a Celeron of the era. And it's definitely much faster than those Intel Atom netbooks, such as the Toshiba NB305 that I did a video about. And 2D graphics is actually slightly faster than the K3 keyboard PC. It scored a 143.8 versus a 131.8. Memory is 326 versus 434. And with the Intel SSD I installed, it's actually faster than the built-in flash chip in the K3. It scored 1319 versus 701. And here's a demonstration of the software-defined audio jacks. I'll plug a cable into what would normally be the microphone input. And it pops up this window on the screen asking me, what device did you plug in? I'll choose line out. And now the pink jack is my line out jack, so I can play music through it. Here's a sample of the built-in speakers cranked all the way up.
Launch from Route 34. Oldies 107.9 is along for the ride.
It is in stereo. So not that great of a sound, but like I said, at least it has built-in speakers. It's better than nothing. The strange thing this computer does is that Linux thinks it is a laptop with a built-in display, and it thinks whatever monitor you plug in is the secondary display. And that was a problem in Ubuntu because all the controls were off the screen because it was thinking this is the secondary display. So the launcher bar was invisible and I couldn't open anything. But at least in Linux Mint, it lets you control everything even though it thinks it's a secondary display. And I was able to disable what it thinks is the built-in display and make the monitor the main display, which solved that problem. So it may take a little bit of tweaking to get the video set up right if you use Linux with this. But this is not a problem in Windows. Windows does not have this phantom laptop display. It only recognizes whatever monitor you plug into it. Here's the inside of the keyboard PC. It's easy to take apart. You just remove the hard drive and take out all the screws, and then the keyboard half separates from the base of it. You have to remove these two connectors. One is for the keyboard itself. It's actually marked here USB keyboard, and the other one is for the keyboard LEDs. Not much to look at on the CPU board itself because all the major components are on the other side. But there's the cooling fan. It's made by Cooler Master. And these are the two wireless antennas for the built-in Wi-Fi. And it has connectors for the left and right built-in speakers. You can see the connectors for the hard drive. And there's a couple wires running from the CPU board to the separate circuit board of the USB ports and the LEDs. And I noticed this one, somebody didn't close the little latch. I don't know if somebody was in here before or if this was never done properly at the factory, but either way, that could be the reason why these USB ports and LEDs are non-functional. The keyboard LEDs do work because they come from the keyboard itself. So hopefully that is just the reason why, and there's nothing actually wrong with this circuit board. And the keyboard does have a metal backplate. I assume that's mostly for RF shielding, but it does help give it a solid feel. And it turns out that loose connection was the problem. I just closed that latch holding the cable in place. I don't have the hard drive in, so you won't see the hard drive indicator, but the power indicator is working now, so everything should be fine now. I just have to test those USB ports, see if that's working as well. And it appears to have fixed the USB ports as well, because now when I plug in the mouse, it lights up, whereas before it wasn't even getting power from these ports. So that's the Great Wall U310 keyboard PC, also known as the Diablo Tech and GigaZone keyboard PC, as well as the Commodore VIC Slim. I just wish somebody would make a newer and more powerful version of this, but as it is, and especially for the price I paid, I'm really quite happy with this. I think it's a really neat little computer to have, since it doesn't take up any more desk space than a regular keyboard, but it's the entire computer. You just need to plug in your mouse and your monitor, and you have a functioning computer. And like I said, it's not good for gaming or HD video that much, but for general web browsing and general productivity type PC software, it's still perfectly fine. But wait, there's one more test I forgot to do. Since this thing has a serial port, I'm gonna see if it supports a serial mouse. And that would actually come in handy because it would free up another USB port. So let's see if this works. There it is, plugged into the serial port on the back. Found new hardware, Microsoft Serial IntelliMouse. And it's working. I'm moving the mouse. That's amazing. A modern PC with a serial mouse. We have two mice. I'm moving the USB mouse, and here is the serial mouse, which appears to be a lower DPI, but it still works. And you can see HID compliant wheel mouse and Microsoft Serial IntelliMouse. Let's see if the scrolling works. Yep, scrolling works. So there you go, you can use a serial mouse of this computer. I love it.